Just a quick one this week, not about C# or about .NET, but actually about Visual Studio and the feature you get in Visual Studio called code completion, whereby as you're typing, it predicts what you're going to type and helps you to put in the right things. And it's something that's really developed over many versions of the Visual Studio IDE, and I couldn't tell you exactly what feature came in where, but I certainly noticed some really big improvements came in with Visual Studio 2022. So let's have a quick look at that, but also look at how you can configure it for yourself, because if it's not doing what you want, then it's not actually a productivity benefit, it's actually a disbenefit. So if you can configure it to do it the way you want it, that's really powerful. So let's just look at some of the things we can do. I've just put together simple console application here, and let's throw in a class, and we'll just call this some class. And then something that I was actually doing in the previous video was a little bit of code like this, where I might have had a private void, and let's call this calc bounds, and then let's take in an I enumerable, so we get the obvious things like just prompting on the basis of what we're typing. And then let's just throw in here a tuple. So we'll have int x, comma, int y, and we'll call that values. And again, it's guessing pretty well that VA, I might want values in there. And then what I'm going to do is let's have an int that we'll call top that equals 0. And then now is where it starts to get really clever, because clearly there is somewhere built in a good vocabulary and some AI that can work out the likely thing to have next. So I've got a top of 0, so it guesses that I want a bottom of 0, it guesses I want a left of 0, and it guesses I want a right of 0. So it can't be sure, I could have wanted something different, but that's the way that's working. And then let's do a for each. So I'm going to have a for each. And again, it's guessed, well, I'm doing a for each, I must have some kind of collection. What's the collection? Well, the only one in this case, but the most likely one is values. So it puts that together for me. I don't like that X there, so I'll put val in there for values, but apart from that, pretty good. And then all I'm going to do is, let's just say top equals, and then math.min. So the top is going to be the minimum of the existing top, or the Y property of that value. So not all that much help it can give us on that first one, but now it's got the idea. It's again incredibly good at working out what the next likely thing is. And it's got bottom equals, well, it's not quite got it right, because bottom wants to be math.max of that. So we've got to put that one in for ourselves. And also we're going to have to put in the Y there. So you've got to be careful there, because sometimes, like autocorrect, when you're typing a message, it can put in what you didn't want, and if you don't check, it may get confusing. But then left, it's worked out exactly right. It wants to be the minimum of left and x, and right wants to be the max of right and x. So once it's got the pattern, it's very good at putting together the additional code and saving as typing. But as I say, always do just check that it hasn't made an assumption that isn't the right one. But that's what we've got there. Another thing I very commonly want to do is use this with fields and constructors and that sort of thing. And you'll notice I've put in just a couple of interfaces here. They don't have anything in them. They're just there as examples, but sort of thing that you might want to inject if you were using dependency injection. So let's do that. And there's two ways we can do it. We can do it by writing the constructor first. So if I just do ctor, again, that's an old snippet for generating a constructor. And then in here, I could put something like I mediator, and it guesses I might want to call that mediator, and I could put I repository, which is the other interface I had, and it guesses I want to call that repository, so that's all nice. But then of course, what I'm typically going to do with those is just pop those into private fields. And we can do that again if we go to the quick actions and refactorings. And then we can either have them as properties, so you can see there, we could have public properties, but typically when you're doing injection, you're going to have them as private fields. So we can click on that, and it generates private read-only fields, and it initializes those in the constructor. The other way we could do it is we could have written the fields first. So if I did a private read-only, and then iMediator, And then again, it suggests that. Again, we could do a private read-only and then go for I repository. And then on that one, we do it in the reverse direction. So I could do generate constructor and it sets it up. And then I could also do on this one, I could add that to the constructor. And so it's achieved the same thing. It's entirely up to you which way round you want to do it. The only slightly nasty thing there is I'd prefer those to be grouped together. But the problem we have in either case is actually it's not following the naming convention that I like to use, because it's called the field simply mediator. Now, perfectly okay to do that, but a very common convention and one that I personally like is to use underscores on private fields. So I actually want to call that underscore mediator, underscore repository. And one benefit of that is it means we don't then have to use the this to disambiguate between the field and the parameter. I can just put my underscore in there and it's much clearer. And that's really why I like it. It's not that I mind typing this so much, it's just in any situation you can look at a variable and if it's got an underscore, you know it's a field. If it's not got an underscore, you know it's either a local variable like we've got with top and bottom, or it's a parameter. And although with the modern editors, because you can just hover over and see these things, it's probably not as important as it used to be, but it's a habit I've got into since starting out with OO programming and lots of people use it. So we'd like to do that. We'd like to take advantage of the code completion, but we'd like to have it our way and for it to generate the underscores, not for us to have to type them in afterwards. And it's pretty easy to sort that out. What we need to do, if you go into Tools and then Options and then go down to Text Editor, drill down in there, you can see all the languages. So you can do this for different languages, but we're in C Sharp. And then we go to Code Style and we go to Naming. So there's all sorts of things you can do here in terms of text editing, but we're just going to look at this one thing. And you can see that to start with, so this I think is pretty much how you get Visual Studio out of the box with nothing added. You can see that we've got these three specifications. We're saying that interfaces should begin with an I. We've got types in general should be Pascal cased, so that's initial capitalization in every new word. And also non-field members, so that's properties and methods are going to be like that. We can see what's happening here. We've got this idea of a specification. So if we look at specifications, there we can see we've got the specification for an interface. And it's pretty obvious, it just is. It's an interface with whatever accessibility. And then we've got the required style begins with an I. So if we look at manage naming styles, there we can see begins with an I. So begins with an I is just a name to give it so that we can keep track of it. But then we can see the required prefix is I, then the capitalization, and then just an example of what we've got. So what we need to do is add in something new in there to do our underscore. Now, we don't need to have a new specification because, as we'll see in a moment, that's already there for us. What we need to do is put in a new naming style. So if we go to naming styles, we do an add, and we're going to call this one underscore fields. So as I say, doesn't really matter, entirely up to us. But then we're going to put the required prefix in this case, so it's going to have an underscore. And it's still not quite right because we don't want that capital E there, so we change the capitalization from Pascal case to camel case, so that the initial letter is not capitalized, but the rest are. So choose it how you like, but that's what I want. And you can see now the example showing us pretty much what we want. So we click OK on that, OK on that. And now we've defined our style, we can then add a new rule in here. So do an add, and now is where we can see that the specification I want is already available because we've got in here a private or internal field. So that's what we can go for. So that's a predefined specification, private or internal. And then on our required style, that's where we can go for the underscore fields, the one that I just added in there. And this will do a couple of things for us, actually. This will help with the code completion, but also if we decide to ignore that anyway, it will give us messages. And so we can see here, if I wanted to, I think that'd be quite severe, but you know, if it's a naming convention that you should have underscores and you want that to be organization-wide, you could make it an error, but I'm just going to make it a suggestion like the other ones are. And so now if we do an OK on that, and now let's delete all of this, and start typing. So I'm going to do private read only. And then again, we'll have our I repository. And you can see immediately it's suggesting not only that it should be I repository, but that it should be called underscore repository. So that's different from what we had before. It's putting that in there. And now I don't need to do the work. And so let's just do it with one of them. If I did my generate constructor from there, then we can see it all works. Or the reverse one, remember we could do the constructor and we were going to say that's going to take a I repository called repository, still without the underscore because we only did this on fields, and then the I mediator, and again nothing there. But now if we do the generate fields, you can see already it's putting in the underscore. So if I do that, it's all working nicely, exactly what we wanted it to be. And it's not a huge saving, but it is just a little bit irritating if it just generates without the underscore and you're typing those in by hand. Lastly, let's just see what happens with those information messages. So let's get this wrong deliberately. So that's got to go back to this dot. And then if we look in the error list, then you can see it's got quite a few of these actually, but it's telling us that we've got those missing prefixes. And it will even do a fix for us. So if you have got it wrong, we can just change it back and it does it all. Well, it fails to remove the this dot, but that's not too hard to do. So pretty simple idea. There's lots and lots you can do in terms of those configurations. I'm not going to go through all the details, but the idea is you can make it so that whatever your personal or your organization's coding standards are, you can get Visual Studio to understand that, enforce it, help you with it, and give you warnings if you get it wrong. So I hope you enjoyed that. If you did, do click like, do subscribe, and I'll see you next time.